When we're talking about resistance, as chips become more compact and tens of billions of transistors are placed in these chips, the smaller those little vias need to be. And so resistance happens when those vias get smaller and smaller, and that's why you need something besides just copper. Let's start this episode with a short story from earlier today here at Chipstock Investor Household. Before I had even had coffee, Nick asked me whether or not I had heard of ruthenium. Now, I spend much of my day perusing the periodic table of elements. However, I did not know what ruthenium was.
Only a weirdo would spend their day reading the periodic table.
I am definitely not being serious. I think I've mentioned before that I almost failed chemistry. In fact, I was playing Candy Crush when you asked me if I had heard of ruthenium.
Okay, that's how the day of research actually gets started here at the CSI office. Let's talk about ruthenium then.
Yeah, let's break down why we're even talking about this element in the light of a new release from Applied Materials.
Okay, so earlier this week, Applied Materials made some announcements regarding their name, what their name implies, materials. If you all boil it down to what they do, they are a materials science company. Before we get to ruthenium though, Kasey, let's back up just a few steps and look at pretty much the highest level view we can look at the semiconductor industry. This statistic, or maybe just this estimated statistic, that the semiconductor industry is going to reach $1 trillion in end market sales by the end of this decade, implying a 9 to 10% compound annual growth rate for the next 7 years. Tell us, what does that have to do with a company like Applied Materials?
Applied Materials fits into a very critical choke point in the semiconductor industry, right there in the middle in wafer, fab, packaging, and assembly equipment. Applied Materials is a large generalist supplier of manufacturing equipment. They have equipment that spans the entire process of manufacturing a semiconductor.
And to get to that $1 trillion mark, if we do get there by 2030, the semiconductor manufacturing process as it exists today is going to have to change. And so in our last video on this subsegment of the industry, we talked about a leader in advanced packaging. Some of the barriers to these process steps are starting to blur a little bit. There's a specific process called deposition that we have circled here that is actually becoming increasingly part of the advanced packaging equipment part of the market. And we're going to talk a little bit about CVD in particular, chemical vapor deposition, and Applied Materials listed in blue in this chart. You can see a leader in various types of equipment that address numerous process steps in semiconductor manufacturing, also a leader in CVD. There's a lot of these companies that fall into that category outside of the Fab Five, Lam Research and Tokyo Electron being the other big two in CVD. Lots of different ways to deposit material on top of a silicon wafer. So one of those critical steps that deposition is used in is 3D stacking of memory and logic chips. These things you can think of not just as a smooth little chip that electricity runs through, but you put these things under the microscope and what appears is this very intricately designed and laid out three-dimensional city where different layers are stacked on top of each other. And all of those layers have to be interconnected so that the chip ultimately works and gets the proper performance as desired.
Exactly. And you can see on this infographic, semiconductor materials include silicon. And silicon is used as that base substrate. But adding that conductive material, traditionally a substance like copper, helps with that electricity flow. Parts of a semiconductor also have insulators which suppress that electricity flow. When you're building these stacked chips, all three of these components are used in making those 3D cities, as Nick called them. This is where this new Applied Materials press release comes in. new chip wiring innovations for more energy efficient computing. You can see that highlighted there in the top of this press release. First use of ruthenium in high volume production for semiconductors. What does ruthenium do?
In layperson's terms, there's a new ruthenium layer being deposited into the most advanced chip manufacturing processes, the 2-nanometer process nodes that you hear Intel talking about, you hear Taiwan Semi talking about, and Samsung, all three of those top logic chip producers, as well as the memory chip makers, Micron, Samsung, and SK Hynix. Ruthenium used in 3D stacking to potentially reduce resistance of copper wiring, the interconnects in those little 3D cities, reducing the resistance by as much as 25%. We appreciate it when people give us a shout out when they found benefit in our research. We're going to do the same. We like the Asianometry channel on YouTube. Fantastic material. There was actually a video over there done about 8-9 months ago that talks all about this, the copper interconnects, resistance, capacitance, low-k dielectrics, and complete with the usual dry sense of humor. Check that video out if you want a more technical explanation of what we're about to talk about.
When we're talking about resistance, as chips become more compact and tens of billions of transistors are placed in these chips, the smaller those little vias need to be. And so resistance happens when those vias get smaller and smaller. And that's why you need something besides just copper, correct?
Yeah, that's exactly right. And Applied Materials has actually been a leader in some of these process steps for decades. Again, that's addressed in that video we just mentioned on Asianometry. TSMC was very quick to adopt that back in the late 90s, early 2000s. But as we often say, and as you mentioned again, here at the outset of this video, Kasey, with the semi-industry flow, it's actually the equipment providers that make this all possible. They help, at the very least, co-develop these process steps for the foundry customers like Taiwan Semi, for Intel, for Samsung, so on and so forth. And so Applied Materials has had this proprietary low-k dielectric film called Black Diamond since the late 90s. And so what they announced is actually an improvement to this process with a combination of multiple chemical vapor deposition process steps, also atomic layer deposition, a different type of method for depositing thin films of material on top of the surface of a semiconductor wafer, as well as PECVD plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition. And they provide some visuals here that show some of the new process steps. And so what ends up happening is you have these little channels that get created to help form the transistors in a chip, the on-off switches that make software code possible. They use these various deposition methods to lay down these layers so that eventually the copper that gets filled in and that carries the electrical signal throughout the chip doesn't bleed into the actual silicon surface. And so ruthenium is one of those new materials that is now being added as a thin layer between the low-k dielectric, the black diamond low-k dielectric film, and the copper wire to help improve that ultimate performance. So maybe a first question is, what exactly is that low-k dielectric made out of? It's a silicon oxide compound proprietary to Applied Materials. There's some old research papers on how this is composed and other elements that can be added or subtracted to increase the properties of that low-k dielectric compound. But that's the first step there in the little blue part of the illustration, the black diamond low-k dielectric. But now you might be wondering, okay, what is ruthenium? I think cobalt is pretty well known. Perhaps you started hearing about that element in recent years as one of the many materials used in lithium ion batteries for things like in electric vehicles. Of course, everybody knows what copper is. It conducts the electricity. What about ruthenium? What is it?
So ruthenium is part of this platinum metals, part of the elements. There's six of those elements. Ruthenium is very rare. It's mined in trace amounts, and it's used to make platinum metals stronger.
Applied Materials, first to help enable mass market production of semiconductors with ruthenium. First question, how are they going to get such a rare element?
Yeah, there's a couple of mining companies that do mine for the platinum metals. You can see Anglo American, as well as another company, Sibanye-Stillwater. And we didn't get a lot of information from this website because they've apparently been recently hit by a ransomware attack and the website was down. So weren't able to dive too much into this, but it's another company located in Montana that mines for these platinum metals.
Back to Applied Materials and this new and improved process for laying down layers to make those copper interconnects perform much better. What's the machine called?
This machine from Applied Materials called the Endura Cubs or Copper Barrier Seed IMS. This machine itself incorporates all six of those processes you saw in an earlier slide from Applied Materials. Pretty high-tech machine.
And a very complicated name to go along with the complexity of the machine.
Exactly.
Here's a fun little aerial shot of the Applied Endura Cubs IMS with Volta Ruthenium CVD. What a mouthful. I think you get the point. This is probably a pretty expensive piece of equipment, and Applied Materials black diamond material needed in tandem with this machine, probably also going to be quite expensive because of the ruthenium. But hey, when all of these leading fabricators or chips are shelling out $400 million for a single piece of equipment from ASML, you know what? I think they can probably handle the elevated cost of acquiring some ruthenium for these process steps.
Can't get this on Amazon. Ultimately, why are we talking about this? Take a look at this slide that we've shown you a few times from Applied Materials. The complexity of chips just keeps increasing, all the way from a commoditized memory chip to a logic chip that is designed by NVIDIA. All of these chips needing this advanced packaging techniques to be able to stack these chips on top of one another to make them more powerful and more efficient.
Many of these process steps that historically we could compartmentalize into a nice little process flow map like we made and showed you at the beginning of this video, the lines are blurring. So a lot of this advanced packaging, like we talked about with the BE semiconductor video last week, some of the advanced packaging is happening at the wafer level itself, not after the wafer is diced up into chips and then packaged onto the circuit board with other chips to make a full computing system. So Applied Materials has a hand in everything across the board, whatever the packaging step is at the wafer level, or once the chip is getting connected to the circuit board, Applied Materials is there.
Applied Materials is one of our oldest stock holdings in this semiconductor manufacturing equipment space. You can see that it has done very well. Total return of about 750% over the last 7.5 years. We don't expect this huge growth run to continue at the same pace necessarily, but certainly do think that Applied Materials has a lot of room to still keep growing. Why is that?
For sure. Everybody in the tech world laments the fact that so many businesses don't have a defensible moat. It's not a term that we like to use very often. We talk about that a lot more in our Discord channel with our semi-insider members. Check that out, just $5 a month. But Applied Materials and really many of the companies in this subsegment of the chip industry, in the capital equipment and the manufacturing equipment, often have a defensible moat because they own the technology that gets used in the manufacturing process itself. If you want to make chips, there's no way around these companies. Applied Materials, it's just in a really strong position. And so as we enter a new phase of growth for the semiconductor market, it looks like all end markets are returning to growth mode sometime in the second half of this year. That bodes really well for Applied Materials over the course of the next 3 to 5 years. I think we're more than happy to continue holding the position we have. This is a core stock in our portfolio for really good reason.
Make sure you hit the subscribe button and don't miss a video. And check out our Semiconductor Insider. It's only $5 a month, gets you access to a whole lot of goodies. We will see you here again soon at Chipstock Investor.